drink. Hurry, Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
And I know in my business, the stuff that we talk about with seniors often is about having, you need to have a healthcare proxy. We'll tell people everybody has to have a healthcare proxy. So that if they are on the floor, there's somebody that can make a decision for them.
They can contact, yeah.
Right? And we sometimes talk to them also, we used to talk to them about DNRs and now more about the MOLST forms.
Right.
And occasionally we would talk about the file of life.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the file of life? And when you get there, do you try to see if there is a file of life around?
Absolutely.
Talk
we,
about
we
that.
We check for everything. The file of life is a magnetized envelope. It's a small, bright red envelope.
Yeah.
And it's used for emergency purposes. So it's mm-hmm. used for the group of us, the fire, police, and EMS. It's patient information. So it would have your name, your address, your identifying information.
Mm-hmm.
It'll have your history, the meds that you take, the doctors that you see, everything that we would need, medications, allergies, everything that we would need to help us assist the patient even quicker, even faster.
I see.
I see that they're on these meds that must be for this reason. And so we know to look for that on the monitor, or we know to look for the specific vital signs of whatever blood pressure medication they be on. So it's huge identifiers.
I see. Now, is that document supposed to have any information regarding how to treat the patient, any instructions from the patient themselves? Is this supposed to be like a healthcare proxy or like a DNR?
No, it's just patient information.
It's just patient information. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that you go through that, and obviously time is everything at this point, so you're kind of going through that,
right?
And now, what if a person has to talk about do not resuscitate forms or the so-called MOLST form,
mm-hmm.
and how that relates to any of the things that you'd be doing?
Okay, so the DNR, it's called the Comfort Care DNR order. This is an order that is specifically for EMS. It's something that can also be seen with the file of life. It can be on your refrigerator, in their pocket. It can be on a wristband. And basically, that will inform us that you do or do not wish to have us to have CPR. So yes, if you're in a cardiac arrest situation,
yep.
and you do not want to be resuscitated for any of your own personal means, you would have that signed by your physician, yourself. It would have been reviewed with your physician. You sign it, and it's something that we have to honor.
And when you're the responder and you're what do you make a conscious effort to go try to find that?
Yes, absolutely.
Where would you look?
We would, like I said, refrigerators, because it does have a magnet.
Yeah.
So refrigerators, side of refrigerators, even towards the back of the refrigerator, you have to kind of really look.
Yeah. So that's kind of the first place that you look is the refrigerator?
The refrigerator is generally.
Oh, because that's typically
right
what you tell people. Put it on the refrigerator.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yep. Refrigerators, medicine cabinets, some people will tape it to their bedroom doors. A lot of people will have the wrist. It's a bracelet that you can get.
And what is that about? What
it's
is
like
the
a little clear bracelet that you can see that it has a DNR order for it, so that you can actually identify that this patient has a DNR order. And
so if you see the bracelet, I would assume obviously the bracelet doesn't actually have the DNR in it.
It's just an identifier.
It's an identifier.
So that you can look for the orders and ask if there's family there. Do you know where these orders are? Because you have to have the orders in order to have it valid.
Right. So if you have the bracelet but you can't find the order, as far as you're concerned, you're not following the order, right?
The bracelet, I believe, is just the identifier. I don't think any of them have come out with ones that have the order inside it.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. And that was kind of the DNR form, right? And DNR means do not resuscitate.
Correct.
And resuscitate means what?
Means breathing, CPR, starting IVs to get the heart started again.
So it's really a set of things. So
correct.
It's not just trying to get the lungs going again. If you're
doing
those, what would you do if you do not have a DNR, right, that says don't do this? What do you do?
You would look to see if they have any other forms, like you spoke of, the MOLST form. That also can be identifier in the same manner, refrigerator and all that. If you don't have any valid paperwork that, that states the patient's wishes, then we would do everything we can to treat all of whether it's a life-threatening injury or cardiac event. We would just go ahead
and what's
treat.
That? So if the person is on the floor and they are not breathing and have no heartbeat.
So they're in a cardiac arrest situation.
That's is that the definition of kind of cardiac
arrest?
Arrest?
Their heart is stopped.
Their heart is stopped.
And therefore they have no pulse and generally they're eventually not breathing.
Right. And then so what do you do then? You have no heartbeat.
So if there's no orders, then we would just start CPR.
And what is CPR?
CPR is cardiopulmonary resuscitation. Yep. It's basically, we do the chest compressions. We will mechanically breathe for you. We will try to get a return of circulation.
This is another important reason why you need the police and fire there. Because mm-hmm. the paramedics are setting up their drugs, their heart monitor, all this other stuff. So you need extra hands to do the CPR, mm-hmm. to get the stretcher ready, to get the people out, mm-hmm. and to help carry them out because paramedics can't stop doing CPR.
They need to be doing the CPR.
They need to be doing CPR, and, or they take turns doing CPR.
And what does the CPR consist of? I confess, I haven't taken the CPR course.
Mm.
I know. Everybody should know how to do this. I don't know how to do this. And the reason why I'm asking that is I know that I was recently doing a presentation with Dr. Michelle Ricardo, a wonderful gerontologist, does a lot of work in nursing homes and stuff, and she was describing the fact that that what has to be done in order to try to get the heart to be going again,
right.
especially when it's done with older folks,
right.
typically involves breaking things. It involves breaking a lot of ribs and stuff. So I just wanted you to give me a sense of what it is, because I haven't seen it.
You're creating
it. Once you see it, you don't want to see it again.
You don't want to see it again.
But anyway, those people that are in the business, it's something that they deal with quite frequently. So.
And it's your chest compressions is a way to sort of manipulate the heart to have the same flow that it had with blood in the first place. So you're pushing down in the area of the heart, and you're hoping that the blood will still come in and do its job and go out and do its job while you're oxygenating, so you want to keep the flow going.
Particularly to rejuvenate the brain cells to keep them going also.
So you've got to get that flow going like right away. And for some reason, I have this image of people also using some kind of electrical machines.
Yeah, they do.
So what's that about?
So in addition to CPR, you would get licensed for the AED defibrillator.
The AED defibrillator.
It's an automatic defibrillator that the.
And I've heard that term too. Yeah. A defibrillator. What does a defibrillator?
Police and the fire. All the police and fire trucks have them on them.
Yeah.
And it's two pads. You slap them on the chest. I shouldn't say slap. You place them on the chest. And you push a button, and the AED tells you what to do.
It gives you.
If it's an arrhythmia that you don't need a shock, it'll tell you do not shock.
I see.
That if it's a type of an arrhythmia where you need to shock, it'll tell you to push the button, and you push the button.
Okay. I see. And so if you hit the shock button,
yep.
So then what happens? You're actually shocking the body?
Correct.
What, into
you're
what, getting?
The heart, the electrical system of the heart.
I get it.
And then that in hopes of that resetting itself, the electrical system resetting itself, so that it could have some kind of a perfusing rhythm, return of...
VTAC, a couple other ones.
VFib. Yeah, those are the general ones. Ventricular fibrillation, which means your heart is, the electrical impulses in your heart are just not working together
not working.
At all, and you're just sort of a quivering kind of.
And do you do that automatically, or before you start doing the CPR, or after, or how do the two connect?
You want to get the electricity in there. If you have it right next to you and you've just gotten there, you want to kind of do the shock. The CPR is incredibly important as well, and that's why we were saying as a team effort, whoever gets there first starts that whole life-saving process, and it's incredibly important. And usually the defibrillator comes in at a later time, depending on who has them. And the police department has shocked many patients with return, fire department, it's a wonderful device.
Now, I know it is a wonderful device, and it has saved a lot of people. I know that when I was talking to Dr. Ricardo and some of the geriatricians, that they've suggested to me that well, I heard a statistic from Dr. Ricard at this last presentation that there was the number of people who are over, I want to say 80, who undergo CPR and live more than 30 days is less than 5%. It's a very, very small number.
It's a small percent.
But I didn't, and I didn't know. I was amazed by that kind of number, right? But do you have any sense from your work in the business as to whether, because I realize you're the emergency guy, so you're not necessarily following the patient through the hospital and through these other stages.
There's so many different types. There's motor vehicle accidents where you can have somebody in cardiac arrest.
Right.
You can have the senior citizen,
right.
The person in the nursing home, all of that. It's just a large scope, and the younger people have a tendency to survive these type of situations better.
Right. Because obviously, at some point, if you're an older person, the heart really isn't going to stop.
Well, you've had some kind of a cardiac disease at that point that's
right.
probably gotten to
right.
the point of cardiac arrest.